If there is anything more controversial after beef in India is the alleged practice of love jihad. I found this word disturbing as well as misleading when the Hindus, Sikh and Christian groups go on to claim that every marriage between Muslim men and non-Muslim women is committed to extend the domain of Islam through love jihad. So is this love jihad or Muslim men grooming non-Muslim women a false alarm? Well, one of the questions surrounding interfaith marriage relates to concerns of forced marital conversions. Marriage in Islam is a legal contract in which, while Muslim women are only permitted within the contract to marry Muslim men only, whereas Muslim men may marry people of the book, usually interpreted by most to include Jews and Christians as well, with the inclusion of Hindus only after the conversion of the girl. And here comes the dispute over love jihad. But before moving forward, let's dig a bit deeper into the definition of word jihad. Jihad is an Arabic word that means to struggle. Jihad is classified into greater jihad, which involves a struggle against one's own base impulses and getting rid of the bad habits. An external or lesser jihad, which is further subdivided into jihad of the debate or persuasion and jihad of the violence. Within classical Islamic jurisprudence, the development of which is to be dated into the first few centuries after Prophet Muhammad's death. The jihad consisted of wars against non-believers, apostates, and was the only form of warfare permissible. However, the primary aim of jihad as warfare is not the conversion of non-Muslim to Islam by force, no, but rather the expansion and defense of the Islamic State. In theory, jihad was to continue until all mankind either embraced Islam or submitted to the authority of the Muslim state. Now, let's look at the arguments of the Hindus, Christians and the Sikh against the concept of love jihad, also known as Romeo jihad, also known as grooming gangs. You might take the argument of the Hindus, Christians and Sikh about love jihad as over-exaggeration and overreaction. But the argument of the right is only as correct as arguments of the left and Islamists about India being turned into a Hindutva-dominated nation by the BJP. Both these arguments are only partially true and partially over-exaggeration. Now, when I say the love jihad is partially true, does it mean that I support the arguments of the Hindu fringe elements? Well, no. Of course not. But I have few arguments that might clear the picture a bit. UK is probably the most developed country in the world right now. So definitely those of the British citizen must be highly advanced and socially aware and educated. But still, the Muslim grooming gangs are rampant in the whole of the UK. And they mostly, or should I say entirely, target teenage Sikh girls by hiding their identity and sometimes even pretending to be a Sikh. The Sikh Council received reports in 2014 that girls from British Sikh families were becoming victims of love jihad. Furthermore, these reports stated that these girls were being exploited by their Muslim husbands, some of whom afterwards abandoned them in Pakistan. According to the Takht Jathedar in Britain, the Sikh Council has rescued some of the Sikh victims and brought them back to their parents. Mohan Singh Ji is one such man who is a granthi in a Gurudwara and has been dealing fiercely with the problem of grooming gangs. And there have been various documentaries about these grooming gangs. These grooming gangs had few things in common: the religion of the culprit, the religion of the victim, and the citizenship of both the victims and the culprit. When a crime like that can be committed in a sophisticated country like the UK, then why not India? Let me give you a few more examples. Kerala in India, despite being one of the most developed state in India, has seen radical Islam making deep inroads and several residents living to fight for the Islamic State. The family of 29-year-old Fatima, who left Kerala to go to Syria for Islamic State, located her in Afghanistan. Fatima was identified by one Bindu Sampat as her daughter, Nimisha, who was converted to Islam. The family had then alleged a case of love jihad. Kerala ki ek Hindu ladki thi jiska naam tha Nimisha. उस लड़की ने अपने आप को कन्वर्ट किया एंड शी वॉज फाउंड फाइटिंग इन अफगानिस्तान फॉर ISIS ऑन वन ऑफ द टेरर सस्पेक्ट्स इन श्रीलंकन ईस्टर अटैक्स लास्ट ईयर विच किल्ड ओवर 250 पीपल वॉज वन ऑफ द अक्यूज्ड पुलस्थिनी महेंद्रन ऑल्सो नोन एज सारा. In an interview, her mother, Kavitha Mahendran, alleged that her daughter was a victim of love jihad. These things are taking place in the most civilized region of the world and of India. So how can you even hail these events as isolated and insignificant? Love jihad was initially alleged to be conducted in Kerala and Karnataka region, according to the Kerala Catholic Bishops' Council. I repeat, Kerala Catholic Bishops Council, by October 2009, up to 4,500 Christian girls in Kerala had been targeted, whereas Hindu Janjagrati Samiti claimed that 30,000 girls had been converted to Karnataka alone. Even if 10% of these figures is true, it turns out to be dangerous. Love jihad. According to the church, Christian women are being targeted, recruited to terrorist outfits, Islamic State, making them sex slaves and even killed. In September 2019, the Supreme Court made an interesting observation. In the case of Anjali Jain, who married a Muslim man in Arya Samaj temple after he converted to Hinduism, it was later found out that his conversion was a sham and he had converted back to Islam after the marriage. In Shahinshah versus State of Kerala, the High Court itself said that there was a concerted effort to convert girls of other religions to Islam and marry them off to Muslim men. The role of the organization Popular Front of India came out in the case. The court noted that there had been 3,000 to 4,000 such conversions in the past 4 years, and it was clear that there was a concerted effort to convert girls of a particular religion to another with the blessing of some outfit. More interestingly, now listen closely. In 2010, a Marxist leader of Kerala defied his own party line over love jihad. Usually communists claim against the concept of love jihad. They don't usually believe in such things. But CPM member, Communist Party member V.S. Achyutanandan, the then Chief Minister of Kerala, told the press in New Delhi that the PFI, the Popular Front of India, was indulging in divisive activities with the aim of turning Kerala into a Muslim majority state. In 2017, a sting operation was carried out by India Today. In a report titled Operation Conversion Mafia, Kerala's conversion factories unmasked. The team reported what they caught on camera: the functionaries of PFI, Popular Front of India, declaring their goals of converting India into an Islamic nation and proudly boasting of converting thousands of women to Islam through institutions disguised as educational or charitable. The Kerala Catholic Bishops Conference Commission for Social Harmony and Vigilance published data on conversion of Christian girls to Islam, stating that around 4,000 girls have been subjected to conversion since 2005 till 2012 after they fell in love. In September, an aspiring model, Pooja, committed suicide after her husband allegedly forced her to adopt Islam. The Islamic marriage is a one-way street because the women cannot convert out of Islam, as apostasy is punishable by death under Sharia, and the woman would invite serious danger to herself and her children if she gives any such indication. In fact, she has to try harder to prove otherwise. Now, important point to note is that it's harder to prove the existence of organized conversion prima facie. Non-Muslim girls come forward and openly accept that they accepted Islam out of their own free will. And there is nothing wrong in that as long as it is about love only. I strongly feel if a girl comes forward and accepts that she accepted Islam, out of her own free will, there should not be any problem about that. However, Muslim and non-Muslim couple can choose a civil marriage under the Special Marriages Act of 1954 if they really love each other so much. But what kind of love is that if a girl gives up her religion and faith, but the Muslim boy don't give up his to express that love? Does love mean that a woman got to convert to another religion while the man just be the way he was? Especially when there is a Special Marriages Act 1954 under which they can marry without converting at all. But only a few couple does that. And interestingly, majority of those couple opted for Special Marriages Act were found to have been Hindu male. And some Muslim men opted for special marriages as well. And that's applaudable. Guys, I'm not an Islamophobe. I'm just saying that a girl marrying someone from another religion, she takes on a fight with her own family and do not have the backup at all in the case things don't go right in the matrimonial alliance. And that just turns out to be a disaster for her. But anything said against love jihad therefore becomes against Islam or Islamophobic. A problem between two communities becomes a religious problem when it should not. To conclude, whatever perspective one takes on love jihad, it can be safely said that it is not a conspiracy cooked out of thin air by Hindu nationalists. As the issue was raised by the Christians in Kerala and Sikh of Britain and Pakistan. However, BJP-backed fringe groups take this concept of love jihad to another level and hail every matrimonial alliance between a Muslim man and a Hindu woman as love jihad. But stupidity of the right do not disprove the existence of a malicious phenomena called love jihad. The phenomena has deeper historical roots and ideological motivations that needs to be uncovered and understood. Intellectual dishonesty over such crucial issues can only worsen the polarization.